as we reference the reading of the Word of God. Travel with us to the book of Luke, the Gospel according to Luke. And the scripture that was read was chapter 1, the first chapter of Luke, verses 26 through 35. And I would like for us to read verse number 31 and verse number 32. When you have Luke 1, verse 31 and 32, just say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's read this with enthusiasm. The Bible, the Word of God reads, "And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great,
and he shall be called the Son of the Highest.
And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David." I want to preach from the subject this morning, the child, the curse, and the cross. If you will repeat after me, the child,
the child,
the curse,
the curse,
and the cross.
And the cross.
You may take your seats in the house of God. Amen. The child, the curse, and the cross. Every year, there are hundreds of thousands of children who are born into this world. All over the continents that spread throughout this earth, there are women who are bearing children who have conceived a child. And that child is brought forth into the world so that the child might be able to live and grow up into a full-grown adult one day, bearing the full responsibility of adulthood, experiencing the joys that come with living, but unfortunately also going through some pain, going through some heartache, going through some difficult times, going through even some struggles. When you consider the world in which we live, it is not unusual to have a child that is born. We see it in our families all the time. There are many mothers in this crowd today. There may even be some mothers to be. We all have had a mother. Someone has given birth to us and has brought us into this world. And here we are living this very day. While we understand that December the 25th is not necessarily the birthday of Christ, somebody ought to say amen.
Amen.
We understand this because it does not equate biologically, astronomically, or atmospherically. We understand that most of the time, historically, shepherds weren't in the field in the dead of winter. But we understand that the sheep were put up in the colder months. And the shepherds, according to the Bible, were abiding in the field, which would suggest a warmer climate or a warmer season of the year. While we as Christians understand that Christ or Jesus was not necessarily born on December the 25th, let us not be over antagonistic and reject the fact that men are rejoicing that he was born. I don't want to be overly critical of the world when the world is at least recognizing that the Savior was in fact born. Somebody needs to be encouraged to know that we ought to be faithful and we ought to give God the glory that a Savior was born, that this child was born, and this child is named Jesus. And of course, Jesus was sent here not like most of us who are born to die, but he came in here to live, to die on the cross. Now notice the text, when we understand that his name shall be called Jesus. Most of us who are born, we are born and we don't have life until we come here. But Jesus is different, because Jesus had life eternal. He was already in the Godhood. He is already the Son of God. He is, watch it now, not waiting to become king, but he was born king. Most of us who are in regal and royal ancestry have to wait for a period of time to be knighted or to be counted a king. But Jesus is different. There's something unique about this person, because this person came to do something that no other child has ever come to do. It is my prayer that this morning, this message will encourage you to see Jesus in a way that perhaps you have never seen him before. I'm thankful for the child. I recognize the curse, and I'm thankful for the cross. And I want to give you these points so that you might be encouraged on this morning. Look at the text. Luke declares. It's interesting that we're talking about a birth, because Luke was a physician. Luke declares in verse number 30. He says, and the angel said unto her, speaking of the angel speaking to Mary, fear not, Mary, thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. Then the text reads, he shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. The first point is, I want to look at this child. This child is a child of promise. He is a child of promise. In the books of the prophecy, the books of the prophets, in Isaiah the 7th chapter, and around verse number 14, Isaiah gives us the message from God. He says, therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and shall bear a child, and his name shall be called Emmanuel. Now, when the prophet Isaiah speaks unto the children of Israel, he is pointing them to a point in time in which a certain child would be born. Now this child that he's speaking of is a child like no other. For he said that this child will come through miraculous means. He said a virgin shall conceive. Now I appreciate what the prophet has to say, for the prophet says, God is going to give you a sign. How do we know that Jesus is the promised Savior? We know it because of the sign. What is the sign? It's the sign of a virgin A woman who has never known a man will bring forth a son, which is indicative of the fact that God must be involved. I say God must be involved. How many virgins do you know that have children yet have never touched a man? But the prophecy says that there's coming a child, and this child is going to come into the world by miraculous means. When he gets here, watch it now, he shall be called Emmanuel. Well, Emmanuel means God with us, which means that this child, which is born, is a child like no other. There have not been children born who can bear the exclaim of being God with us. I know that there are a lot of children born, but there is no child like this child. Isaiah will go on and say in the 9th chapter, around the 6th verse, he says that unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, of the increase of his judgment, and there shall be no end. Upon the throne of David, his kingdom shall reign forever. Now, when you're looking for the Christ, you need to be certain that you find this child. Well, what is this child? This child bears the prophecy, bears the promise that one day God will make intercession for man. And what will happen is a virgin will bring forth a child. But it's not just any child, my friends. It's a child that is born king. It's a child that has been born to save man from sin. It is a child that is coming to be the redeemer of mankind. It's a child that is coming to select those who have selected God in eternal salvation. And everyone, no matter what your ethnicity, no matter what your background, no matter what your affiliation, if you want to see God's face in peace, you have to come by this child. This child is different, family. This child is different, and I don't have a problem with the world chiming in hark the herald angels sing. I don't have a problem with the world chiming in, oh little town of Bethlehem. I don't have a problem with the world exclaiming that God sent forth his son, born of a virgin, and he laid in a manger. I don't have a problem with this child, because this child is the Messiah. This child is the Christ, and this child will save us from sin. Luke says that this child has been born, and that this child has been born by the will of God through the power of the Holy Spirit. No wonder John, the apostolic writer, would write that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word was made flesh. Here it is, dwelt among us. Yes, I'm thankful that God sent his son by miraculous means, and we have a testimony of Christ's life this day because a child has been born. I see this child. The family, we ought to see this purpose. Now, I said I don't have a problem with the Christmas carols, as they say, but I want you to know that it's all about Christ. Amen. It's not about retail. Amen, somebody. Amen, somebody. It's not about what gift you're going to receive. And it's not about, amen, an economic gain at the end of this season. But if you're going to acknowledge the child that was born, you need to understand that the child of promise was born because there was a problem. Now the problem is the curse. I say I'm talking about a child, a curse, and a cross. Well, the child is Jesus, no doubt about that. But there's a curse. The curse is the problem. Jesus is the child, he's the promise. But also there's a curse, and the curse presents a problem. Run with me to Romans the 8th chapter. Romans the 8th chapter. And I want you to see this for yourself. Romans the 8th chapter. Then we're going to go to Galatians the 3rd chapter. I want you to look at this, family. Never forget that the child came because of the curse. In Romans 8 and verse number 1, the Bible says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. Here it is, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Listen, law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus have made me free from the law of sin and death. Verse number 3. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness, here it is, of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. Verse number 4. That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Is that in your Bible? Verse number 5, for they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life, and here it is, peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then, they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Now watch it. The text tells us that Jesus is the Christ. Not only is Jesus the Christ, but Jesus has come to redeem us from a curse. Now, don't miss this, because we headed somewhere. I say there's a curse. Now, when you sing these Christmas carols, amen, when you, whatever you do, when you do whatever you do, you need to remember that there is a Christ, and that the Christ came by the promise, but don't forget the curse. Now, here's why I say I don't have a problem with the world, at least recognizing the birth of the Christ. Now, here's what people do. What we do many times is we accentuate and highlight and magnify the birth of the Christ, which is the promise, but we forget about the curse, amen, which is the problem. Now, watch it. If you're going to talk about the promise, don't forget the problem. If you're going to talk about the child, don't forget forget the curse. What is the curse? What is the problem? It's called sin. Now, every man who has ever lived has had to deal with sin. Someone says, I don't have to deal with sin. Well, if you don't have to deal with sin, I can rest assured sin has been dealing with you. Am I right about it? Because all have sinned. It didn't say y'all have sinned. It said for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Which means that all of us, Brother Davis, all of us, Brother Ellis, have to fight against sin. That's a problem. How do you know it's a problem? It's a problem because it got Adam in the very beginning. How do you know it's a problem? It's a problem because it got Cain in the beginning. How do you know it's a problem? It's a problem because it got Noah in the beginning. Sin is the world's greatest problem. Am I right about it? But I'm so thankful that while we have the problem, God provided the cure. And the cure comes through the promise. And the promise is that a child would be born. Am I right about it? Now watch it. Now watch it. The child would be born, but the child is not born just to be born. All right. Amen, somebody. I wish somebody would help me preach this lesson. I say the child is not born just to be born. Amen. The child didn't come to this earth to have life. He already had life in eternity. You and I are born to have life. But Jesus has always lived because he's from everlasting. God will help you here. He's from everlasting to everlasting. Thou art God. There is no beginning. There is no end because he has always existed. So this child, not just like any other child, he's no ordinary child. Amen, somebody. I said Jesus is no ordinary child. This child has come into existence because he's coming by the promise that a virgin shall conceive. This child is coming into existence because there is a problem, and the problem is the curse, and the curse is that we are under sin. Listen, the reason I'm not going to assassinate the thought of the Christmas carol is because if the child is never born, then the curse is never alleviated. Am I right about it? If the child does not get here, then the curse is here to stay. I'm thankful I have a God who promised us a long time ago that a child would come. But the child would come because man has a problem. And because man has a problem, man is under the curse. Well, pray tell me, God, how you gonna get us out of the curse? A child is gonna be born. Amen, somebody. Praise the name of Jesus. I'm thankful that a child was born. And not just any old child. I'm thankful that his name is Emmanuel. Yeah, God with us. Listen, when we couldn't come up to where God was, God said, forget it. I'm coming down to get them. Am I right about it? He saw every man fall. He saw David fall to sin. He saw Solomon fall to sin. He saw Samson fall to sin. He saw Ezekiel fall to sin. He saw Daniel fall to sin. He said, but if I bring myself down here, I'm going to be born, but they might be redeemed. Amen, somebody. Amen, somebody. And I don't mind singing a song about Jesus if the song is about the child who was promised to come. Get from Galatians 3. But watch and say, put it on. Galatians 3, verse number 13. I just want you to see this problem. Amen. The Bible says what?
Christ has redeemed us.
Watch it now.
The curse of the law.
Christ, I told you the curse. Didn't I tell you? Christ has redeemed us
from the curse
of the law.
He made a curse.
He made, watch it now. being made a curse, read,
for us.
For it is written, cursed is every man that hangeth on a tree. Read on.
That the blessing of Abraham, Gentiles,
by
Jesus Christ.
Watch it, might come to the Gentiles through Jesus Christ. Read on.
That we might receive the promise of the Spirit
through what?
Through faith.
Through faith. Now watch this. I want to explain this because there might be somebody in here who has never heard this explained before. I want to make sure when you leave, you get it. Here it is. The child had to be born because there was a curse. Question. What is the curse? Now, many of us, if you look at it just surface, you would say that the curse is death. And that seems logical. But in context, Galatians 3:13, the curse is not so much death as it is the law that came because of sin. Watch this. Under the law, you had to do exactly what God said, how God said it, and the moment you made one infraction, you were eligible for the death chair. Am I right about it? Watch it. The reason that man is under the curse is because man is under the law. And the reason man is under the law is because man has fallen from the obedience of God, and now God put a law to get him back in fellowship where he once was. Stay on the line. So the curse is not so much death as much as it is law, because the law couldn't free us from sin because we sold under sin. Why? Because Adam sinned in the beginning. Which means now all the flesh is contaminated, prone to sin, and needs redemption. Watch this and stay on the line for my deeper scholars. The Bible says God drove him out of Eden. You would also remember that one of the consequences for a man sinning is that God pronounces a curse upon the serpent. There were two curses in Genesis, in the Garden of Eden. First curse was regarding the serpent. Do you remember that? Then the second curse, this is Genesis 3:14-15 if you're looking for a reference. And then the second curse regarded the ground. Amen. There were two curses. And that was the curse of the serpent and the curse of the ground. Someone said, well, what happened to Adam? Adam got evicted. Amen. Touch your neighbor and say, Adam got kicked out. Amen, somebody. Yeah. And watch it now. So now Adam is kicked out of the Garden of Eden. God says we have to protect the tree of life. So he puts two cherubims who guard the tree of life, drives man out of the garden, because if man gets a hold of the tree of life, then the problem is a problem that has to stick around forever. Don't get this. Away from us for eternity, God had to send man out of the garden. Then he guarded it because he know that Adam got some kinfolk that like to come back and get stuff that don't belong to them. So he had law enforcement guarding the tree. Am I right about it? Now watch it. It was never God's desire that man should die in the first place. There were two trees that were opposite of each other in the garden. There was the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and the tree of life. And you know, I've always asked myself this question: why didn't Adam eat of the tree of life? I mean, if there were two trees and he had a choice to pick which one he was going to pull from, why didn't he go to the tree of life? Why didn't he go to that tree? Amen, somebody. But instead of going to that tree, she listened to the serpent. She went to the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And now, Houston, we have a problem. The problem, what's the problem? The problem is sin. Well, wait a minute. How you going to deal with sin, God? I've got to separate man from the tree of life. Because if he gets back to the tree of life, he'll live, sin will live forever. That's what God said. He'll be like one of us. Ain't that all right about it? Yeah. Can you imagine Adolf Hitler living forever? Can you imagine Idi Amin Dada living forever? No. So God had to stop this thing. But watch it now. In order to get man back in fellowship, God brought forth law. Now watch this. I've often asked myself a question. Why did God bring forth law? There was no written law in the beginning. It was the word of God. Oh, stay on the line. We going somewhere. There was no written law. It was the word of God. That was the law. Adam is driven out. But Adam doesn't stop sinning. Everybody who looked like Adam got their hands dirty with sin. How do you know this? This has to be the case, because by the time you get to Genesis 6, God is sorry he ever made man. Am I right about it? You know why? And we know why it's in the text. Because sin stuck in the nostrils of God. God smelled that. He said, man, there's no good. And then what does he do? He brings a flood. Spares one man out of the flood. This man is Noah. He has seen and reigned. He's seen the water on the earth. He's seen all of his kinfolk perish. And the only people who are saved is he and the seven other individuals in the ark with him. Watch this. And as soon as he gets out on safe ground, what you think he does? He go right back to sin. He find the Hennessy. He brought love. Oh, hallelujah. I say, before he brought law, he brought love. That's why I believe, and y'all can kick me out when I say this, but I believe that if you're going to lead somebody, you need to have love in your heart. Because love is the universal language. See, when I know you love me, you can tell me I miss five scriptures. I don't even get upset with you, because I know you love me. Am I right about it? Trying to whip somebody, you better get ready to get whipped back. But before God brought law, he brought love. How do you know this, preacher? Because he brought a man by the name of Abram and told him to get out of your homeland. Go by faith to where I tell you to go. Am I right about it? Abraham sojourned in tents and tabernacles, not knowing where he was going, but just trusting the love of God. He didn't know where he was going, but he was trusting the promise. said, I'm going to bless you. And all of your seed going to be blessed. And the whole earth going to be blessed by your seed. But know in your mind that was pre-law. That was pre-law. Why is that important? In that Abraham came before the law, that's the love of God. This means that now God is not just looking for a select group of people, ethnicity wise. He's trying to save the entire world, because you do realize that Abraham was Gentile. Now, see, you got to go to Bible class to understand this. I can't, amen. I'm kind of going, I don't have time. Listen, Abraham's pre-law. And since Abraham's pre-law, here's the importance. Now, I'm about to tell you while a child was born. I'm about to tell you, here it goes. When Jesus is born, Galatians 4:4 says he was born of a woman under the law, right? But he's not going back to get only Jew. He's going back to get Gentile. Because before there was Jew, there was Gentile. Which means that mankind as a whole dwelt and fellowship with God. And God says, I'm not just looking for ethnicity. I'm looking for those who love me out of a sincere heart. And I'm going to save you, not on the basis of the law, but on the basis of my love. Because before my law came, I gave your love to Abraham. And if you identify with Christ, who is the child, you don't get the law. You are free from the law. And now you are under the love because you are Abraham's seed. The child had to be born because he had to redeem us from a curse. Now, how did he do that? He had to become, this is my third point. He had to become, that's my final point for somebody to take that home. I'm the point that he had. That's my final point. He redeems us by becoming a curse for us. Now, your question is, at what point does he, the child, who's dealing with the curse, the promise, how does the promise, the child, meet with the curse, the problem? How does he deal with it? He has to, first of all, become a curse himself. Now, how does he become a curse? The scripture just told you, Galatians 3:13-15, he has to get up on the cross. Somebody missed it. I'm talking to this side. The only way, y'all wake up here? The only way that the promise, which is the child, deals with the curse, which is the problem. The child, which is the promise, has to deal with the curse, which is the problem, on a cross, which is the purchase. Y'all getting this? If the child is not born, then the promise is not fulfilled. And if the child is not born and the promise is not fulfilled, the curse is still in effect. But the curse presents a problem, because God wants to save us, but he can't save us. Child was born. I don't know what to do, but I'm thankful that the child That's some powerful theology. And only that child could deal with that problem. And in order to do it, he had to hang from that cross. I got some other scriptures to give you, but you have y'all sleep on it. But for those that miss this Bible class, you tell them when you get home, you tell them. You tell them that God has done something that no man could ever do. And it's more than just rehearsing a few lines come Christmas time. Hello, somebody. Come on, come on. Jump on back in here, traditionalist. Jump on back in here with me. I'm getting where you want me to be. Yeah, what I'm trying to get you to see is that Christmas don't just come one day a year. Gonna celebrate even her birthday just one day a year. Hello. But we're not talking about my son. We're not talking about my wife. We're talking about my Savior. And every first day of the week. Every first day of the week, that's Christmas to me, because a child was born. Because nobody else could do what this child has done. Nobody. And so when you understand who Jesus is, you understand you're coming to the rock of our salvation. You understand that you're coming to the Son of God, the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And you know now why you're coming to Him. You're not coming to Him because you're trying to look like somebody else. You're coming to Him because He wants to turn you into the image of God. How do you do that? You do that by coming through His blood. What did His blood accomplish on the cross? He purchased the church. He purchased the called out. And those who have been called out must walk in newness of life. That's what it's all about. That's what Christmas is all about. And not only is that what Christmas is all about, really, that's what our lives should be all about. I'm just going to tell the truth of you. Yeah, every day is Christmas. Every day. Yeah, I know the origin of the name, and I'm not getting all that. What I'm saying is, theologically speaking, we celebrate Christmas every first day of the week. Don't we, Christians? Amen. And the reason we do it is because of the child, the curse, and the cross. Stand in your heart. Say yes to Jesus. Believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Be willing to repent of all of your sins. And confess the sweetest name on your tongue. Say, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And the urgency for coming to Christ is that you don't know where death is. That's why it's very urgent. You need to get to Christ just as soon as you can. And when you get to Christ, you obey the gospel and you are baptized for the remission of the sins. Listen, baptism is the legal transaction that takes you out of Satan's hands and puts you into the hands of the Savior. Amen, somebody. And if you're not understanding what a legal transaction is, then you don't understand what having a house means. Because before they give you that house, there must be a legal transaction. You got to meet at the table with some folk. And you got to come up with some money. Hello, somebody. Yeah. And you have to come up to sign your name. Why? Because it's a legal transaction, which means once you have finished paying all the payments, the deed is your name.
Am I right about it?
Yes.
The title is in your name. Christ wants us to be in his name. And that's why we don't come another way. Have to come by Jesus Christ. And when you come to Christ, he puts you into his church. And you leave rejoicing. Not because of what some so-called reverend said, but because of what the reverend one has said. Amen, somebody. You can come to Jesus right now. You can leave here rejoicing. If you need prayer, do it right now. Whatever you do, don't leave here without being on the Lord's side. Will you come? That's the thing we sing together, the song of invitation.
I really love the